the braking drills. While it is true that you will find the rear brake of little use under hard braking, it's a good idea to find out exactly what happens when it is locked up and sliding. The simplest method is to ride along the track at a comfortable speed, then lock up the rear brake. Observe one important caution while making this test. If the rear end of the machine slides out of line with the front end and you let up on the rear brake, it will, or can, snap back into line with the front wheel. If the front and rear are severely out of line, this action may be so abrupt it could throw you and the motorcycle down. Some motorcycle safety instructors suggest you can avoid the above situation by leaving the rear brake locked until the machine is stopped or nearly stopped. This may not always be a practical solution, especially while racing. It is possible, with practice, to guide the wheels back into alignment with body English and pressure on the handlebars, then let up on the brake and continue. The best situation is to not have locked it up to begin with. Here is a drill you can practice to learn the lockup point and sensitivity of your rear brake. Step 1. Ride along at a comfortable speed in an area with no traffic or distractions. Step 2. Apply the front brake at a steady and even rate. Step 3. Apply the rear brake gradually to learn how much pedal pressure it really takes to lock it up. Step 4. Repeat steps 1 through 3 until you know when the back brake will lock up. Do it at various speeds and braking forces, remembering that the harder you use the front, the lighter the rear will be. The front brake drill. The purpose of this drill is to find out how much lever pressure is required to lock up the front wheel and what happens to the bike when the wheel is locked. Without this information, you'll always be afraid of the front brake to some degree. Step 1. Ride along at 5 to 10 miles per hour. Step 2. Lock up the front wheel, using only the front brake. You will notice that the front wheel turns under or turns in when it is locked and the bike feels as though it's going to fall over. It will, if you keep the brake locked. The simple and only solution is to let off the lever until the slide ends. The bike will straighten up immediately. The same thing that happens at 10 miles per hour will happen at 100 miles per hour. The only mistake you can make with a locked front wheel is not letting off the brake lever soon enough. At 100 miles per hour, the strip of rubber you put down on the pavement will be longer than the one at 10 miles per hour. If you leave the wheel locked for 1/10 of a second at 10 miles per hour, the wheel will slide for 1.5 feet. At 100 miles per hour, it will slide for nearly 15 feet. The bike, of course, has more forces keeping it upright at 100 miles per hour, but it feels the same as it does at 10 miles per hour. Cutting costs. The purpose of these exercises is to find the point where the brakes lock and to become accustomed to that feeling so you'll know what to do if the brakes lock while you're riding. That kind of surprise can cost you $9. If you're familiar with it, it costs 25 cents or less. Step 3. Repeat steps 1 and 2 above at higher and higher speeds until you are certain what happens and are certain you can control the machine. Braking and downshifting. Downshifting is closely associated with braking because the two almost always occur at the same time. From observation, it appears that most riders believe the engine is supposed to help slow or stop the bike. When you hear an engine spinning up toward red line going into a turn, you know the rider is trying to use it as a brake. The engine is not a brake. It is supposed to increase the speed of the machine, not decrease it. At any place where you have to use the brakes and downshift at the same time, it is not efficient or correct to use the engine to slow you. There isn't much weight on the rear wheel to begin with, and using the engine means you're going to have to replace the cranks and pistons sooner. If you wish to slow down the rear wheel a bit, use the rear brake. It's cheaper to replace brake pads than crankshafts. Secondly, it's not correct to use the engine as a brake because that's not the purpose of downshifting. The purpose of downshifting is to bring the engine into the right RPM range as you begin to accelerate out of a turn. Most riders seem to feel it's necessary to downshift as soon as possible after they begin to brake. In some cases, there isn't time for a leisurely approach. The downshifting must be done immediately. But if there is time to wait, change gears when you can do it more leisurely. The bike doesn't care. Going into a turn, the bike doesn't care what gear it's in. The right gear matters only when you begin to accelerate. If you have a third gear turn at the end of a sixth gear straight, and part of the turn requires constant speed running, the bike will not mind if it's in sixth gear through that part of the turn. Of course, it's important to make the correct number of downshifts at the proper location. This usually isn't at the first opportunity, just as you begin braking. The best place, usually, is not when you're in the turn leaned over. That upsets the bike somewhat when the gear changes are made. Changing gears in a turn may cause the bike to bob up and down, as the shifts will affect traction and steering. The best place to make the gear changes is towards the end of the braking, but before the bike is actually put into the turn at a steep lean angle. You'll save a lot of attention by knowing how many gear changes to make before coming into a turn. If you don't know this, you'll feel you have to start downshifting immediately in case you make a mistake. This is why many riders begin the downshifting too soon. You don't have to know what gear you're in so long as you know how many gears you have to go down. It's amazing how much attention can be freed up by simply knowing this and doing it.